Number 8, letter A. The number of kilocalories in food is determined by calorimetry techniques in which the food is burned and the amount of heat transfer is measured. How many kilocalories per gram are there in a 5-gram peanut if the energy from burning it is transferred to 0.5 kilograms of water held in a 0.1 kilogram aluminum cup, causing a 54.9 degrees Celsius temperature increase? All right. So there's a lot of things going on here, right? So whenever there's a lot of stuff going on, I want you to create like a little picture and try to create like a little story. All right. Should help. So basically, we have this peanut. And you know that there's energy inherent in food. I mean, that's the whole point of the kilocalorie labels, right? And now you might say, well, wait a minute, they're labeled in calories. Well, actually, no. The calories, quote unquote, the calories on the nutritional labels are actually kilocalories. Whenever you see calorie written with a capital C, that's actually kilocalorie. If calories went written with a lower C, like C-A-L, that's just a regular old calorie then. So a little confusing, right? I guess I don't know why they do that. Well, it's probably useless to write all those zeros anyway, but you feel better, right? If you're thinking you're consuming this, but you're really consuming kilocalories, right? Instead of you look at the label and you're like, oh, this is only 200 calories, rather than saying, oh, this is only, you know, 200,000 calories. I guess it feels better to only be consuming 200 calories rather than the true value of 200,000 calories with a little C. Anyway, so when we burn this peanut, we're going to assume, by the way, a completely beautiful conversion of the energy that's inherent in this peanut into heat energy. Okay, beautiful conversion. Nothing's lost. Obviously that's not true, but if there is something lost, we won't really be able to. We don't know what the value is, so we have to assume, you know, just like in a lot of problems, we assume like no friction and stuff like that. Same thing here. So whatever energy that comes out of this peanut after it's burned, right? The energy comes out, like when you burn wood, right? Energy is coming out of the wood, okay? Actually, ever think about where that energy in the wood comes from? Right? Where does it come from? It actually comes from the sun, right? If you trace it all the way back. So when you burn wood or you have a fireplace, whatever the case is, and you're burning wood, right? You're literally seeing and feeling the energy from the sun. All right, it's kind of interesting. Actually, there's a very famous physicist named Richard Feynman, and he has some wonderful lectures out there, quite honestly. And I wish I had half of his passion for teaching physics. And you should definitely check out some of his videos. Very, very interesting discussion. And he talks about, in one of the videos, he talks about fire and wood and all that stuff. And I never really thought about it that way. And after he said it, I was like, oh my goodness, it's so fun. Now, every time I see a fire, I just think, I just think of the energy coming from the sun. And I'm feeling the sun energy that was stored in that wood. You know, and it's actually historical too, because the energy that tree absorbed was in the past. Right, so you're really seeing like historical energy coming out of the wood from the sun. It's kind of amazing. Anyway, sorry guys, let's get back on track. So now, where were we? Right, the energy that's lost from this peanut, then, okay, in terms of heat energy, will then be transferred. Remember, heat energy doesn't go anywhere. It's transferred. It's not created or destroyed. It's just transferred. So the energy that's basically lost from this peanut will then be absorbed by this water solution. And the water, by the way, is in an aluminum cup here. Okay? So you would expect that if you burn something, right, and you take that energy and then you transfer it into something else, you know that this thing is going to heat up. And that's actually what it tells us, that this cup with water in it, and remember, it has an aluminum exterior, the change in temperature of that entire system is going to be 54.9 degrees Celsius. That is of the water and the aluminum. You might say, well, it doesn't say either. It doesn't say for the water exclusively, aluminum exclusively. It will be both. There is no way that this water will heat up without that aluminum heating up. All right. That's why, unless you've ever, you know, held a metal cup, you know, if you put something hot in it, it gets really hot. If you put something cold in it, it gets really cold. That's why most cups are not made out of metal. Anyway, so what I need to now somehow figure out, that I have to kind of backtrack, right? I have to take this information. They told me a mass of aluminum, right? I had to look up the specific heat of aluminum. I know the change in temperature of that aluminum. Also, we're also talking about this mass of water, right? I'm looking at this mass of water. We memorize the specific heat of water. And then it's water, the temperature of the water is also changing, right? So I can kind of do like a two-track analysis. I can talk about the heat gained, heat, energy gained. First, let's do by the water. All right, by the water. So I would use this formula over here on the right-hand side. That's going to relate all my variables together. So that's going to be the heat gained by the water will be equal to the mass of the water multiplied by the specific heat of the water multiplied by the change in temperature of that water. So I'm going to write little W's on the bottom here. All right. So we can now just simply plug in. So the mass of the water, they told us, it has to be in kilograms. So 0.5 kilograms. So 0.500. And it has to be in kilograms because I'm going to use the kilogram value for the specific heat. This is probably memorized. You're going to be seeing this frequently. So, or you might be able to look it up on a table. 4,184. And then the change in temperature of that water. Now it increased. So you know this change is positive because the final is higher than the initial. Right? So this is 54.9. And now let's just calculate it. Okay. So this is 0.5 times then 4,184 times then 54.9. And now this works out to be 1.15 or so, 1.15 times 10 raised to the 3, 4, 5. And that's in joules. All right. So that's the amount of heat that was gained by the water. Well, why don't we now analyze the aluminum? Because that's also going to gain some heat as well. So we do the same analysis. The heat gained by the aluminum will be equal to the mass of the aluminum multiplied by the specific heat of the aluminum, multiplied by the change in temperature of that aluminum. So again, the heat gained by the aluminum will be equal to the mass in kilograms, 0.100. That's what they told me in the problem, right? It's right here. Multiplied then by the specific heat, that you probably have to look up. I don't think you have to memorize that. 900, then multiplied by that change in temperature again of 54.9. All right, let's see what it works out to be now. So now we have the Q then of the aluminum will be equal to 0.1 times 900 times then 54.9. And here we get 4,941 about, right? Or 4.94, hopefully I said that right, 4,941 times then 10 to the third. And this will be in joules. All right, so let's think about this. If the aluminum had gained this amount of heat energy and the water had gained this amount of heat energy, what was the total amount of heat energy gained by the water and the aluminum? It's a simple addition, right? It's a simple addition. So now all you have to do basically, take these two values then and you add them together. That would then tell you the total. Okay, so we'll say Q sub T now for total heat. And I'm going to try to use the exact values in the calculator. So we're going to say, so we're going to say plus then. Let me go back to grab that exact value. And when we add them together, it should work out to be about 1.20 or so. Now I'm rounding again, 1.20 times 10 raised to the, 3, 4, 5. All right, and that's in joules. Now remember, if this was the total heat energy gained by the water and the aluminum, where did the heat come from? Where did that heat energy come from? Oh, it had to have come from the peanut, right? It had to have come from the peanut. So basically, you know that if the water and aluminum gained this amount of heat energy, that heat energy had to have come from somewhere, and it came from the burning of the peanut. So basically, we can you know write something like this, that the heat energy, the total amount of heat energy gained by the water slash aluminum equals the amount of heat energy lost, right, by the peanut. Right, so the value there, because it's lost from the peanut, it's negative, but that's not important for this problem. But this is a very important concept, and just how to think through it is very important. So now what we realize is that the heat energy then And I'm just going to write the positive answer here. Well, I'll write it as negative. Q of the peanut would then be equal to negative because it's losing it, okay? Negative 1.20 times 10 raised to the fifth joules, okay? Now what are they finally asking us for? Well, let's go back and read carefully. It says, how many kilocalories per gram? Oh, man. All right. So I got to do a conversion. Right? I got to convert these joules into kilocalories. So why don't we do that? All right. So let's do, and now I'm just going to use the positive answer because it's just saying how much kilocalories per gram are there in the peanut. So kind of before it was lost, right? It was inside the peanut. So I can just drop this negative term. Remember, that just means the flow. The magnitude is what's important here. So now I have to take the 1.20 times 10 to the fifth joules and then convert that into kilocalories. So remember that in one kilocalorie, there will be 4,184 joules. And then you can simply do the conversion. So just divide that answer. I'm going to divide the exact answer by 4,184. And we get about 28.6. So there are 28.6 kilocalories, KCAL, in total here, okay? Not per gram yet, but this is the total amount of kilocalories that came out of this 5 gram peanut. Now, if you want to then know how many kilocalories there are per gram, what do you think you got to do? Well, all you have to do now is going to take that total amount of energy, 28.6 kilocalories, and then divide it out by the 5 grams. And now, lo and behold, again, I'm going to use the exact answer. So this works out to be about 5.73 or so. 5.73 kilocalories per gram. All right. In other words, when you look at the label, it's not going to say kilocalorie per gram. It's going to say calorie, but the calorie should be capitalized. If it's not, they're technically wrong. But even if they don't capitalize it, you have to know that food calories are in terms of kilocalories and actually not just regular calories, which I know is, I'm sure, is extremely confusing here. But I'll leave that part up to you. If you got some peanuts in the house, go check the back of the label. All right, and see, you know, there's servings, and then there should be an amount of grams per serving. And then you can figure, if you know the amount of grams per serving, you can then figure out the kilo, and you know the kilocalories per serving, you can then figure out the kilocalories per gram. All right, guys, hopefully this helps. Please remember to help us out. All right, hit that subscribe button. And even most importantly, if we have helped you, we might be able to help your classmates. And that would be the best if you wouldn't mind mentioning our channel to them. That's really the biggest thank you we could get. We're not asking for Patreons or anything like that. All we're asking you to do is just, you know, spread the word. All right, guys, thank you so much. Take care.